ever happened to me. Can't imagine my life without you. Where I would be forevermore. I thank you, Lord, that I've been redeemed. Jesus, you're the best thing that ever happened to me.
My life, you have been. is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. Great to each and every one this morning. We have sunshine this morning.
Amen.
The Lord is shining on us today. Let's turn to page 209. And our soul-stirring song and hymn, page 209. Let's all stand as we open up this morning service. We'll sing 1, 2, and 4. Page 209.
There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in any earthly skies, for Jesus is my light. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful happy moments roll, when Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in the soul. There's music in my soul today, a carol to the King, and Jesus listening can hear the songs I cannot sing. Oh, the sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll, when Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul.
There's
gladness in my soul today, and hope and praise and love, for blessings which he gives me now, for joys laid up above. Oh, the sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll, when Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in the soul.
Amen. Cody, open us up in prayer.
Well, good morning. It is the first Sunday of the month of February. It's hard to imagine that January is over, but it is. And here it is as we enter into the month of February. In our bulletins this morning, of course, still waiting on construction to begin and things, so just need to keep the church in your prayers and all that. Miss Barbara's surgery went well and she's doing good, so we need to keep praying for a complete healing there. It looks like she's probably going to be absent for about 3 months. as she's going to be, she's at her her daughter's recuperating and things. So, you know, so it is what it is. But we keep praying for her. This coming Wednesday is February the 8th, and we will pray in the month during the midweek service. And for anybody who may be listening out there, we have a sign-up sheet on the table in the foyer for Valentine's. We are going to be going to Martinez Restaurant and eat Mexican food. And we're going to meet at the restaurant at 5 p.m. on Saturday, February the 11th. So if anybody out listening or watching us wants to go, then you need to call us and tell us that you're going or whatever, because we want to be able to have a head count so that when we call to announce or call Martin, we'd be able to tell them something. So those are what we seek. We have some birthdays and an anniversary, and none of them are here this morning, so it's hard to sing to them if they're not here. So we won't on the back. Of course, there's always something on the back of the bulletin, and it's truly worth your reading, I do believe. So I hope that you'll read it and contemplate it upon it this morning.
Continue in our soul singing songs and hymn. Turn to page 162. God be the glory. We'll sing all three verses.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Father, through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus
Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Considered the coast of Caesarea Philippi. And this area is predominantly all Gentiles. And it's located some 25 miles north of the Sea of Galilee and north of Bethesda, where Jesus had just healed a blind man, according to Mark 8, verse 22 through 26. And it's here that we find in this area, there is a place, and I've been there, and we find that there is a spring that issues forth from Mount Hermon. And it forms one of the tributaries or the headwaters of the Jordan River. And this area that Jesus and his disciples it's a beautiful area, but it was steeped in pagan religion. In ancient times, the city had been called Belenus, and because it had been a center of Baal worship, and Baal was the Phoenician god of fertility and nature, and later the name was changed to Panias because the Greeks believed that their god Pan was born in a cave in the hills above that city at the foot of Mount Hermon. And Pan was literally, in the Greek mythology, was half goat, half man god who was believed to be the guardian of flocks and nature. And in fact, the modern name of the ancient city is Banias, which is a form of Panias. So anyway, we find, and in Caesarea Philippi, there was also a gleaming marble temple built by Herod Philip to honor Caesar, the Roman emperor who was considered to be a god. The citizens of the city were required to enter this temple at least once every year, place a pinch of incense on a burning altar, and proclaim, "Caesar is Lord." But in this, it's kind of ironic that Lord played that last song, because that is the subject of today's lesson matter. In Matthew chapter 16, if you'll take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 16, you can find your place. Let's stand as we read God's word this morning. Matthew 16, verse 13 says, and it says, "When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, 'Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?' And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, But whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Let us pray. Lord, we do come thanking you, Lord, for an opportunity, Lord, to get up this morning and to come into your house and to worship you this morning, Lord. Lord, we ask now that as we open your word, as you would reflect your word upon our spirits, Lord, that as we leave this place today, we will be changed by what we have heard and by what we have read. It's with that that each and everyone said, Amen, and can be seated. It was here in Caesarea Philippi, in that place known as Bannias, in this city devoted to the worship of idols and man-made gods, that Jesus chose as the place to make a fuller revelation of himself to his disciples. And it was also here that Simon Peter saw for the very first time that Jesus Christ was truly the Son of God. We find that Jesus used this tragic backdrop of paganism and false worship to cause the disciples to think about the most vital issue of life. And that issue is, who is Jesus to you? Correctly understanding who Jesus is means the difference between being saved and being lost. It means the difference between heaven and hell. So we want to take a close look at our Savior's question that was questioned in verse 15. And the question is, whom say ye that I am? We find your answer to that question determines how you will live your life, not only here, but it will also determine where you will go when you leave this life, when you die. It is the single most important question that you will ever hear. Or that you will ever answer. So this morning, we find this place sets up out at the foot of Mount Hermon. And this place, as you go in, pool after pool after pool after pool after pool as you go up in to where they went. And as you go uphill, one pool empties into the other and empty and empty and empty, and then it forms the tributary to form in the headwaters of the Jordan River. Now in this, you keep going up, and then you come to a big rock formation that's there. And in that rock formation, there are approximately 9 or 10 different monuments, places of worship for pagan gods. The temple, the place of worshiping Pan is there, and in this is the place in which we're talking. It's all in this one hill, this formation of the rock. And we find that there is a, literally a cave. It's a very deep chasm that's in there, and that's where the water comes from as it comes out of that cave, and then it flows in and forms these pools down below. The water's crystal clear, and it's cold. And all, but when they worship Pan there, they would make sacrifices, and these sacrifices would then be thrown into this deep cave or chasm there, and unto Pan. Now it has been said that in this place is literally called the gates of hell, and in that area, people there in the days of Jesus and things, they literally thought that cave was the very entrance down into hell from there. So that's where, you know, we get these ideas. We find later on in these verses. But first, you know, we have to understand just exactly what Jesus, the question is, and the question is, whom say ye that I am? Now he asked them, well, who do people say that I am? And they told him, some say that you're John the Baptist, some say you're Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. And so then Jesus turns the question around. And he says, well, who do you say that the Son of Man is? And then, of course, we find Peter's answer there in verse 16, where Peter announces, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. So we find this. And we wonder, when this question is being announced, and first it was to outside of the disciples, okay, whom do men say that I am? Then he asked the same question to just personally to include the disciples. He said, well, whom do you say that I am? So we look, and we have to get into this, to answer this question of who Jesus is, we first have to take that the question is being presented to us. Who is Jesus to us? Well, in answering that, we first have to ask humanity. We have to ask, what have men said in the past? You know, during the life of Christ, men had a lot to say about him and who they thought he was. There in verse 14, shows us some thought of who Jesus is to be, that man thought. Some thought he was John the Baptist, a holy man willing to die for his faith. Even King Herod thought that Jesus was John the Baptist raised from the dead, there in Matthew chapter 14. Some said that he was Elias or Elijah, the greatest of all the Old Testament prophets. The Jews were expecting Elijah to return just before the Messiah came in Malachi 4 in verse number 5. Some believe that Jesus was the forerunner, but not the Messiah. Okay. They said that he was Jeremiah, a holy prophet who was expected to return to earth just before the Messiah came. He was supposed to bring with him the tabernacle, the Ark of the Covenant, and the altar of incense, which had been hidden in Mount Nebo before he died. Now, we don't have these because these are found, those things are found written in the Maccabees, those things that were written in between that 400 years of silence between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And then we find they said, or one of the prophets. You know, a man of God sent with a message for their time, or a man in whom that dwelt the spirit of one of the great prophets. But as we look even to these, we have to realize that all of these views elevated Jesus above the status of just some ordinary man. They show that the Jews at least believed him to be a great man, perhaps even a holy man, but their views of him fall far short of what is required for salvation. So we find, you know, not everyone in Jesus' day thought that he was a great man. Some thought he was nothing more than a nobody. And some even thought that he was an evil man. According to Scripture, some thought he was a lowly carpenter in Mark chapter 6. That he was nothing more than the son of Joseph in John chapter 6. That he was a sinner in John chapter 9. That he was just an illegitimate child in John chapter 8. Some thought of him as a devil in Matthew 12, or a madman in John chapter 10, or a fool and the object of contempt and scorn in Matthew 27. Even his half-brothers had harsh things to say about him in John chapter 7. So when we look at these things, this is what man said. And this was in the day of Jesus. Okay, well, what about man today? What do men say in our present day? Just as men had an opinion concerning the identity of Jesus in his day, so they still do today. And here's what a few people are saying about Jesus. Now, the Jehovah's Witness, they will claim that Jesus, that Michael the Archangel, is none other than the only begotten Son of God, now Jesus Christ. This is found in their book of the New Heavens and the New Earth, page 30 and 31. The Mormons, now, they think that Jesus, our elder brother, was begotten in the flesh by the same character that was in the Garden of Eden, and who is our Father in heaven. Now, this came from their Journal of Discourses, volume 1. Then, they think that Lucifer, the son of the morning, is our elder brother and the brother of Jesus. This is by Apostle B. McConkie, Mormon Doctrine, page 163 and 164. It's also been said that Jesus was married at Cana of Galilee and had many wives, including Mary and Martha, who also had man children. And we're back to the Journal of the Discourses. And we find that it's also believed there that Jesus was the first baby born to God in heaven when God in a physical body had relations with Mary, his own daughter, and he is the spirit brother of Lucifer. Okay. What does Islam say about Jesus? Well, Islam says that Jesus was no more than a mortal whom Allah favored and made an example to the Israelites. They are unbelievers who say God is Messiah, Mary's son. And that's in the Shura, chapter 43, verse 59. Jesus was basically a prophet, but he was not crucified on a cross. He will return, but he is not God. So says Islam. Hinduism literally proclaims Jesus as just one of millions of gods. They kind of put him right on the level as they do with cattle and stuff. The Jewish Talmud, which is Jewish writings that detail how Jews are to live their lives, has the following things to say about Jesus. She, who was the descendant of princes and governors, played the harlot with carpenters. Now, this was according to the Sanhedrin 106a. Miriam, or Mary, the hairdresser, had relations with many men. And this was the Shabbat 104b. Jesus was executed because he practiced sorcery, Sanhedrin 43a. Jesus is in hell being boiled in hot excrement, according to Giffen 57a. The Jewish Encyclopedia pictures Jesus as blind in one eye and lame in one foot. Now, you know, we look, and these are what different earthly religions have to say about Jesus. People living all around us have an opinion concerning Jesus Christ. Some think he was a good man. Others think he was a good teacher. People hold all types of ideas concerning who Jesus is. What is sad is that nothing that I have just shared with you thus far is even close to the truth. All of these people and all of these groups have ideas about Jesus, but none of them are biblical ideas. And since humanity cannot help us determine the identity of Christ, maybe, perhaps, we need to just ask heaven itself. We find the sovereign God, the Father, what he says about Jesus. Well, this is what he said in Matthew 3 and in verse 17. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. He also said in Matthew 17 and verse 5, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. Now this is from God the Father. What about the spirits? What about the spirits of God? The spirit world has something to say about Jesus. Now, the heavenly spirits, they literally in Matthew chapter 1 and in verse number 18, these spirits say, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on the wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream. saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Now, the angel of the Lord, this is a heavenly spirit. We look, what about the other side? What about the hellish spirits or the demons? We can look in Matthew 8 and in verse number 29. We find that this was just after Jesus calms the wind and the sea there on the Sea of Galilee. And verse 27, the disciples said, but the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? They went over to the Gergesers, anyway, is a place, and coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass his way, was this crazy man, and he had demons within him. And behold, they cried out, saying, What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? So we find that the heavenly spirits proclaim him as God's Son, come to take away the sins of the world. The hellacious demons and spirits proclaim him as the Son of God. We could even ask the scriptures, which are nothing more than God's inspired word, and we find that the Bible is filled with information about the deity of the Lord Jesus. Even the names given to Jesus in the Bible, they speak of his position. He is called Lord, and this implies that he is in control, that he is deity. He is called Jesus. And literally this name means Jehovah is salvation. This is his earthly name. And it reminds us that he is human. He is called Christ. And the name means anointed. It refers to Jesus as the one chosen by God to be the Messiah. The Bible is crystal clear of who Jesus Christ is. But if you need more examples of this, you can go to Isaiah 9, verse 6, Micah 5, verse 2, Isaiah 11, verses 1 through 5, Jeremiah 23, verse 5, Isaiah 53, 1 through 12, John 1, 1 and 14, Mark 1 and verse 1, Philippians 2, verse 5 through 11, Acts 2, verse 36, Acts 10, verse 36, to name a few of them. So the Bible is clear. What about the saints? You know, many of the great figures of the New Testament, they offered their testimony as to the identity of the Lord Jesus Christ. As Jesus told Peter in Matthew 16 in verse 17, it says, "And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven." So we find that, you know, the very knowledge of who Jesus is does not come from the human heart, it comes from heaven above. What about the Savior? What did he have to say about himself? What a person says about himself is important in discussing their identity. And here are some of the things that Jesus said about himself. And John 14, verse 9, "He that has seen me has seen the Father." In John 10, verse 30, "I and my Father are one." John 8, verse 58, "Jesus saith unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am." John 14, verse 6, "Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." We find John 6, verse 35, "I am the bread of life." John 8, verse 12, "I am the light of the world." John 10, verse 9, "I am the door." Verse 11, "I am the good shepherd." Verse 36, "I am the Son of God." John 11, verse 25, "I am the resurrection and the life." John 14, 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." John 15, 1, "I am the true vine." All of these things were spoken by Jesus concerning himself. C.S. Lewis once said this, "A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level with a man who says he is a poached egg, or he would be the devil of hell. You must take your choice. Either this was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about him being a great teacher. He was not left that open to us. So we look. We've seen what humanity has to say about Jesus. We see what heaven has to say about Jesus. What about asking our own hearts about Jesus? Let's hear from other hearts. You know, in the pages of the Bible, there were people who had a personal encounter with Jesus that forever changed their lives. What about some of these? What about Simeon there in Luke chapter 2, verse 28 through 32, who said this, "Mine eyes have seen thy salvation, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." Now, he was talking about Jesus. Nathanael, in John chapter 1, verse 49, he said, "Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel." What about the woman at the well in John chapter 4, when she said this to the people, and said, "Come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ?" What about Martha in John chapter 11? It says, "Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which had come into the world. And then what about the dying thief on the cross? One side, that thief mocked God, Christ. But on the other side, that dying thief said this: one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, "If thou be Christ, save thyself and us." But on the other, answering, rebuked him, saying, "Doest not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss." And he said unto Jesus, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus said unto him, "Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." We find the Roman centurion standing at the foot of the cross in which they hung Jesus on in Mark 15, verse 39, proclaimed, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." What about Thomas? John chapter 20, verse 24 through 28, who proclaimed, "My Lord and my God." There are many other witness accounts that we could call to testify out of who Jesus is. But these are sufficient to see that any life that is touched directly by His is a life that is profoundly affected. What about hearing from our own hearts today? We have heard from man. We have seen that among humans there are also those that deny Jesus as the Son of God and the only way of salvation. We have other testimony from lives that have been changed by Him, and these indicate that He is who He claims to be. We have heard that God Almighty has said about Him. We have listened as the angels gave voice to what they know to be the truth. They have even heard the grudging witness of the demonic spirits of God. We have heard enough to be convinced that Jesus Christ is someone about whom we must make a decision. And with that in mind, I wonder today, what does your heart have to say about Him? Is He just a baby at Christmas? Or a man on a cross at Easter? Or is He the crucified and the risen Lord of your life? Is He a way to God, just one among many? Or is He the way, the truth, and the life? Is He a good man, a great teacher, and a prophet? Or is He the very Son of God and your only hope for salvation? Is He a liar? Is He a lunatic? Or is He your Lord? What is the testimony of your heart today? Are you trusting Jesus and Him alone for the very salvation of your soul? Have you faced a time when you saw yourself as a sinner and Jesus Christ as your only hope? Are you trusting Jesus and Jesus alone for your soul's salvation today? Well, if we could hear from the Bible for one last time, we would hear perhaps maybe these words. The words found from John 3, 16 that says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." What about Acts chapter 16 that proclaims this is the jailer that had Paul and Silas and kept them in jail. And he said in Acts 16 verse 31, it says, and they, what he's asked in verse 30, and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Verse 31, and they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." What about Acts chapter 4 and in verse 12, we find this is Peter and John are arrested, and this is from Peter's sermon to the council, and he says this in chapter 4 and in verse 10, it said, "Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you all. This is a stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither," verse 12 says, "neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Yeah. We go into chapter 10 of the book of Romans, and we find there in verse 13, it says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Verse 9 says, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." Yeah. So where do you stand in the midst of all this? Who is Jesus to you? That's the question. That's the question that was asked back in Matthew chapter 16 of Jesus asking to his disciples, those that lived, that walked, that ate and traveled with him, sat under him, seen the miracles, and seen the things that he was able to do. Just who is Jesus to you? Is your answer one that will guarantee you a home in heaven when you leave this place? Is your answer the kind that pleases the flesh, the world, and the devil? Or is it the kind that pleases the Lord? You see, we got in the world today, they want the testimony. They want the words of the blood-bought redeemed that are saved by the blood of Jesus. They want us to change our message about Jesus. The trouble is, it's not our message to change. It's God. Are we saved this morning? These questions are vital. The most vital of all questions is the one question we began all this considering today. Who is Jesus to you? Simon Peter got the answer right in verse 16. He only got it right because the answer had been revealed to him by the Lord in verse 17. And right now, the Lord is revealing His identity to our hearts today. He is convicting you of your sins, and He is drawing you to Himself. Now is the time of salvation. Now is the moment to be saved. Right now, you're asking, well, what should I do with Jesus? One day the question will be, what will Jesus do with me? What will you do with Jesus? Jesus is standing at your heart's door, standing and waiting. He's not before. This is a question you face once more. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. One day your heart will be asking, what will Jesus do with me? At your sad heart, He is knocking still, longing to enter your soul to feel. You must accept or reject His will. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. One day your heart will be asking, what will Jesus do with me? Oh, will you leave Him alone outside? Or will you choose Him, whatever betide? This is the question you must decide. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. One day your heart will be asking, what will Jesus do with me? You see, Jesus wants us to see what He is with us. We see that in Matthew 16 when He was talking to the disciples. Simon Peter answered, "You are the Son of the living God. You are the Christ." And yet, that same question is the same question that's been plaguing man for centuries. Who does man say that Jesus is? And Jesus turned it around to a more personal question, because He asked the disciples, who do you say that I am? Well, I give you today, in our world, in our time, on this day, He's asking us, who do you say that Jesus truly is? Let's stand. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come thanking You, Lord, this morning. We thank You for Your very essence of life that You give us. Lord, we thank You for the beautifulness of this very day. Lord, we thank You for Your precious word. And Lord, the very question, Lord, it was brought by Jesus Himself, about who does man say that I am? And then He asked those disciples, just who do you say that I am? Lord, it's the same question that each of us is going to have to answer. Someday, sometime, every single man, woman, boy, and girl on the face of this earth for now until you return is going to have to answer the question of whom Jesus is. Jesus wants to know. I believe he's asking us today. He's seeking, he's searching our hearts of whom we say that he is. Is he liar, lunatic, or is he Lord? Lord, all the evidence points to Lord. Help us to see that this morning. Lord, use this invitation as only you can.
Page 261. Whoso are you weary and troubled, hide in darkness, see. There's life for a look at the sea.
Heart to stir has been brought out. Jesus wants to know from us today just whom we think he is. We all have an answer. And that answer has a lot, or is the determining factor of where we'll spend eternity. Me, he is Lord. Who is he to you today? We'll be back in Ephesians 5 this evening. So I hope you'll come. In Calvary Baptist Church, we say, amen. Praise the Lord.